Hello. Today we're going to talk about video editing. Well, what you need to know about it so that you can build your PC in an effective way. This won't be an academic video, not by a long shot. So please feel free to leave a comment with corrections in order to help other people. So let's begin. Firstly, you have to ask yourself a few questions. For example, what camera are you going to use? Is it going to be a 12K monster or maybe a cheap consumer camera? Do you know what codecs are you going to use or what bit depth, resolution, all the other formats that you will work with? Also, one of the most important things to ask yourself is what issues are you going to solve? Are you a video maker that needs just some simple basic editing? Or are you a virtual effects artist or a colorist that perhaps needs some beefy graphic cards to accelerate your workflow? Because while it's true that usually with an expensive system you can do basically everything, it is always better to choose each component in order to have the best result for the money. The components for a PC are always the same, so I will try to help you with answering your questions first. Then, after you answer your questions, you can focus on the hardware needed to get your results. So, every camera got different parameters that you must know before buying it. They all got their quirks, but for the sake of this video, let's focus on what will actually impact your editing and production experience. So let's begin with the bit depth. When you see that a camera can record in 8-bit or 10-bit, etc., basically without getting into too much details, what it means is that the sensor of your camera can process and record more color information. A higher bit depth allows for more shades of color. That is useful for color grading or color correction. You probably won't need more than 10 bit because it kind of gets invisible to the human eye. So it is not a necessity unless you are doing really heavy color grading or if it's required in a really big production set. Then we have the bit rate. That is the amount of data that get processed per second. So it's a very important value that influences the quality and clarity of your videos, especially with extremely dense and detailed subjects like waterfalls or a forest full of trees, and also for capturing heavy and fast movements. Since the bitrate has a different effect on the size of your files, let's talk about compression. As for pictures, when you compress the file size, for example, from a PNG file to a JPEG, you will lose a bit of quality, but you will get more manageable files. Video compression works in a similar way. We have all intraframe or all eye, and this is a method that saves each frame, giving good quality results, but with large files. And the long group of pictures or long GOP. That is basically not saving every frame, but just the difference between frames. So it requires more processing power, but gives smaller files. So potentially lowering the quality a little bit, but like the bit depth, it's kind of difficult to see with the human eye. So there is no real difference in the actual footage. Then we have chroma subsampling or color sampling. And this is basically how many colors are sampled. It is different than bit depth, because bit depth concerns how many shades can be represented for each color. Kind of impossible to notice with a human eye, but it is useful for green screen work, so if you work with virtual effects, and heavy color grading. Color sampling is measured in a format like 4:0, and that reduces color data for smaller file sizes, or 4:4:4, that maintains full color detail. It's best for high quality content, but it requires more storage. Now, let's talk about the codecs. A codec, short for coder-decoder, is a tool or software used to compress and decompress video files. We have talked about OLI and long GOP, and those are compression strategies that can be applied using codecs like H.264. So H.264 and H.265 are the codecs themselves, which define how the video data is handled. When you record or edit a video, the file can be very large. So a codec compresses the video to make the file size smaller, making it easier to store and share. So when you want to watch the video back, the codec decompresses it so that it can be played back smoothly. Common video codecs are H.264, that is widely used for streaming and like Blu-ray and stuff like that. It can be taxing on the CPU during editing. H.265 or HEVC, it offers better compression than H.264 for high resolution videos, but requires media engine acceleration in order to work properly. So think about Intel iGPU or GPUs, NVIDIA 5000 series, etc. There is also AV1 for streaming and other codecs, but I wanted to add the RAW video format since more and more cameras are implementing it. RAW is the unprocessed data captured directly from the camera sensor. It retains all the original image information and it is not compressed, making it ideal for high quality production. But that means that files are going to be massive, so you will need a ton of storage and you will probably need a graphic card in order to denoise in it and work with it with less effort. Now, before we jump into the actual meat and potatoes of this video, let me add two more variables to the mix: resolution and frame rate. Resolution is the amount of pixels that your sensor will resolve, improving the overall sharpness of your image. Higher resolution are used for cropping and zooming in without losing details. Frame rates are the amount of individual frames per second. So recording in high frame rates is useful for recording fast movement or for slow motion. Both high resolution and high frame rates are heavy for the CPU and GPU and require more storage. Everything becomes much more difficult when you are working with multicam setup. So now that we have a better understanding of what the variables are and what gear we're going to use and all of that jazz, let's talk about the hardware for your PC, the CPU. So we have talked about needing more and more processing power, right? Well, the CPU is the main piece of hardware that does basically all the operations that we need. So when you are looking for a CPU, the main things that you should focus on are the number of cores, the single core speed, and if the processor got an internal GPU and codec acceleration. Four or more cores are pretty much the standard nowadays, and a high number of cores will speed up your rendering times. A clock speed of 3 GHz and above, I guess, will give you a good timeline response, and that's the minimum speed I will suggest. Keep in mind that modern Intel and Apple CPUs may have two kinds of cores, performance and efficiency. For video editing, they are kind of fine, but if latency is important for your job, for example in music production, try to find a CPU that only uses performance cores, like a 12600 non-K from Intel. AMD CPUs only use performance cores, but they don't have the codec acceleration that you may need for your workflow. In that case, you have to pair the CPU with a GPU like the Intel ones or the NVIDIA 5000 series and beyond, I guess, in the future, because right now the 5000 series is the latest gen. But we will talk about the GPU later in the video and I will also give you some buying suggestions. After the CPU, we got the RAM, the random access memory. RAM is really important. It helps the CPU to access data quickly, so the playback and editing speed are improved. It helps with handling larger files without slowing down the system and much, much more. When you're looking for the RAM, the things to know are the generation. So right now, DDR5 is the latest one. The capacity, so how much memory are you getting, like 32 gigs. And the speed and latency, for example, 6,000 megatransfers and cast latency 30. I could go much more in detail with this, but just keep in mind that if you're working with high resolution footage or just heavy files in general, having a big amount of memory is usually more important than having a faster one. For maximum stability, go check out your CPU specs page and you will find the suggested RAM speed from the manufacturer so that you will be completely sure that you'll have a stable system. Then we have the storage. We can divide this into two categories: the traditional hard disk and the solid state drives or SSDs. But the SSD itself can be divided as well. So when you are searching for your main drive, be sure that the SSD is an M2 NVMe type of SSDs. Those are little sticks similar to the RAM, and they are much faster than regular SSDs. Get a good capacity drive and keep an eye on the read-write speed. Right now, a mid-range PCIe 4 SSD should work fine for the majority of projects if the size is enough. For a production machine, it's always better to use different memories for different goals. A very reliable and stable SSD for your operating system, even a 500 gigs will be plenty. A fast SSD for your programs and file, I guess 1 terabyte is the sweet spot. And a regular SSD or a traditional hard disk for your finished project. This drive could be as big as you want. The bigger the better, so go wild. Now we have the GPU, the graphic unit, and this is basically a highly specialized CPU with thousands of little cores that accelerate video-specific tasks. The GPU have a personal RAM, it's called VRAM, that it can access it in order to execute the task faster and without the need of going into the system RAM. The GPU speeds up rendering times, so it helps with heavy editing and effects like denoising, stabilization, 3D, etc. It can improve the quality of life of your work. If you are working with heavy codecs, the GPU's decoders and encoders will help you. For example, if you use a CPU without the iGPU. The issue with the modern GPUs is the pricing. I will probably go used or with a Intel GPU if using an AMD CPU right now. Otherwise, like the 5000 series from Nvidia, it's kind of difficult to suggest right now. If the prices go like super low in the future, I don't know, I could see the use for it. But right now, I won't suggest you, so just to be clear. So what else do we need? Well, we've talked about all the sexy components like the CPUs and GPUs, etc. But the power supply and motherboard are two of the most important things, actually. I will suggest you to check out the PSU tier list. There you will find all of the best rated power supply units and choose accordingly to your needs. Every time you upgrade your CPU or GPU, keep in mind the wattage. As for the motherboard, I'm looking for expandability, a lot of connecting ports, and enough places to put my SSDs. For the case, as well, it depends if you want to have one with fans already pre-installed, or if you prefer to have a glass panel one or a mesh one. You know, for this you have to do your research and choose accordingly to your taste. Ergonomic mice and trackballs, the Stream Deck and other external hardware can be beneficial for improving your workflow. And of course, check out the best screen that you can afford and go search for a color accurate one, all right? I have made a kind of a general example. All right, let me just disappear. Here we have some builds that you can do accordingly to your use case. This is the example build. It's for solo video makers, content creators, if you are using 8 or 10-bit entry-level cameras. I put an asterisk here because if you're using this CPU, you want to work with some heavy codecs like 422, 10-bit, you have to add a GPU. I've put the Intel B580 because it got a lot of media engines and codecs accelerators. The Nvidia 3060 right now is a bit older, so yeah. But this is basically my PC right now. I've built it last week and I found it to be pretty good. I've used the i5-12600 because I found a super great bargain. Then I've also put this. This is a mid-range, but yeah, right now it's kind of expensive. This is a build that I would suggest for maybe a small crew, some like visual effects artists, or if you're working with multiple cameras, this should do the trick. Then this is like the super expensive build. Oh shoot, I put the link here, right? Well, you can max out everything, like you can put more RAM here if you want. But yeah, with this build, I guess that you should be fine, like without going into Threadripper territories. All right, I've put an example on how a system can become updated for the jobs that you may have in the future. So it's not unusual to start with, of course, with what you have, so like a mobile phone or perhaps your first camera. And I'll use myself as an example. I've always been in the music production and music making world. After years and years of working in that industry, I bought myself a consumer grade camera, a mirrorless one, because I wanted to work with some visual for my music. But after a while, I wanted to record some of my friends playing live music and jam sessions. So after a while, I was then contacted by some other musicians and that I met during those sessions. And I was proposed to work with them. And then I got my first paid job as a videomaker, completely random, you know? So at first they called me just to record their performances, so both with audio and video, and to just mix the audio. But then they asked me to do some editing and color correction, and the job kind of becomes more complex. And that was the first time that my machine actually struggled. The export times were awful, the editing itself was super laggy. So I started working with proxies just to speed up the process. Now, last week I've built my first machine, and now I can edit my files with basically no issues actually. But I haven't upgraded my camera yet. I haven't used any kind of insane effects for my production. And that means that in the future I will probably upgrade the parts accordingly to my needs. So knowing what the components do will help you with upgrading instead of buying a new machine every single time. This is not sustainable. It's not the best route, especially right now that everything is extremely expensive. Go with what you need specifically and don't just throw money at the wind. Just make sure that the conditions are good, because sadly right now marketing is everywhere, and everybody wants to influence people to buy the latest and greatest stuff. Just remember, if your system is working and you have no issues with it, I mean, right? You may invest your money towards other things that will help you without creating any kind of issues for your PC. Like, for example, lights or lenses, you know, or more hardware that can help you, like the Stream Deck. And yeah, that's it. I will leave the graphics that I use on this video as a guideline that you can download and use later when you need it. Thank you for watching. I will post new videos every time that I can, since I have other jobs and a life. If you have any questions, please feel free to leave a comment, and also if you have video suggestions or ideas, just leave it down there. Cheers.